Ernest Holmes, the founder of this philosophy, wrote, "We believe in eternity, in eternal loving kindness." I believe in eternal loving kindness. This morning, we are focusing on loving and kindness and unity and oneness. So I want to start with a story. Some time ago, Neil and I were walking down Bernard Street, and we came across a young woman who obviously was distraught. Upon a closer look, we determined that she was impaired, but we still decided and made the call that she was in serious need of assistance. You see, she had been ferrying off this gentleman who had seemed to be trying to take advantage of her because of her condition. So I approached her, and Neil went to deal with the man. That's right, he did. As I neared her, I said, "Can I help you, sister?" And she was fighting off, saying, "No, no, get away, get away, get away." And I said, "Listen, baby, I can see that you're in need of some assistance right now, and I'm offering myself to you. I'm on your side. Please let me help you." So she said, "Okay." Her purse was spilled over on the street. She was disheveled, and parts of her bosom were hanging out because of how she had fallen. And so I assisted her and helped her get to her feet. Get to the ground. She told me the story that her and her husband had been drinking and they were walking back to their vehicle and she just couldn't make it anymore, so he took off to go get the car. And the other gentleman that Neil was dealing with, who was not so gentle, was being quite abusive and mean to her. So it was by now, as she was telling me this story, that she was silently sobbing. And I looked her in the eyes and I hugged her and I said, "You're not alone. You're not alone, I'm here with you." Then her husband came around the corner. Neil and I helped her into the vehicle and off they went. I don't know what her reaction was in the morning. I don't even know how she responded or even if she remembered what had gone on. But in that moment, what I do know is that we had a connection and her and I both knew it. She was open to receive my assistance, my kindness, my unconditional love to her. We believe in eternal loving kindness. I believe in eternal loving kindness. And Neil and I left in that moment as we were walking home, thinking that perhaps we left her life a little bit better, or easier, just easier, because of that little small kind of actness that he and I bestowed upon her. Do you understand and realize that there is honor and personal comfort in knowing that you can help another get through a day or a circumstance or a situation? Do you know that? There is, and it's true. And I want you to know that for that brief interaction, it really affected me a lot. It affected me a lot for these reasons. And another point in my youth, in my time, that could have been me on the street, disheveled and lost in moments. It could have been my son or even my daughter who was in that situation, and I would have prayed that someone would have been kind and loving towards them, such as we were to her. Every woman is somebody's daughter, right? Everybody is somebody's child. Neil and I, we talked about it on our way home, and what came to us is, why was this woman, or even if it was a man or anyone, why is anyone for that matter allowed to sit alone and cry without the outreach of kindness and love? Crowds were walking by, taking videos of her and just ignoring her condition. Whether or not they were judging it, I don't know. But why were we the only ones who came forward to help this person? In our society, when did watching the pain of another become entertainment? What I mean by that is where we place our attention, it expands. If I focus on judgment, if those people walking by were focusing on judgment, unforgiveness, criticism, condemnation, what's going to show up in my life? You know darn well what's going to show up in our lives if we're thinking those things, those very same things. It can be easy in our world today to get caught up and to allow those thoughts to become our dominant thought pattern. We have choice, folks. We all have choice. Where we focus our attention, where we place the majority of our attention is going to be that outward tree in our lives. Then becomes the practice. To choose loving kindness each day can be as simple as extending a kindness, forgiving an error, finding something beautiful to behold. We choose to live not only from the mind when we do that, but then from our heart as well. Now we've got the full connection. Dr. Holmes used to say, pulsating with a deep feeling, choosing love again and again and again and again, regardless of the situation, the circumstance, or the appearance. Now, I don't want you to hear that I'm a hero simply because we stopped to support this young lady, because we chose to learn from a judgment that we have had in the past. And I'm almost ashamed, a little embarrassed to share this with you, but in the honor of transparency, here's some humanness for you. A year before this incident, there was another woman, an older woman, that Neil and I would see almost every day on the streets. And I don't know if she was homeless, but she certainly wasn't of the working society. Neil and I'll speak for myself, Heather, I judged this woman. I would see her and assume that she was an addict or some other unfortunate whatever. I filled in the blanks. In my mind, I pictured her whole life. Total judgment. Have you ever done that? See somebody and then you assume that you know their whole story? Well, I'm sorry to say that I did this to this beautiful soul. And I had to forgive myself. But it wasn't until I was having lunch with my son and his wife and my grandbabies that this woman walked into this establishment where we were. It was a hot, hot summer day, and she came in just to ask if she could have a glass of water. Well, my son and his wife and my grandchildren all leapt to their feet and ran to this woman and hugged her and were praising her and giving her all this love. You see, they totally embraced her, every single part of her. People in the restaurant were looking, but it didn't matter to them. And if I were to say that I was in awe, would be a total understatement. What I had already decided, this woman who was smelling of alcohol and what I assumed was homeless and an addict, was holding my grandchildren. And they were loving her. And my son introduced me to her as his friend. And our babies start to teach us, right? When she joined us for lunch, we found out she was quite lovely. She was quite lovely. And at another time in her life, she had been a nurse, and she had her own children. And her past had led her to this moment in her life. But folks, she was pure love. Afterward, this person, who obviously had very little of monetary value or stature, even offered what she had as little gifts to my grandbabies. The person who I thought had nothing had everything. She had everything. Sorry. My tissues say that. She had everything. Absolutely everything that she needed. And she so humbly accepted lunch for my son, and then she blessed them when she left. That circumstance, that experience, years earlier, showed me how to embrace that young lady on Bernard Street to help her. It was in that moment that I decided I would never judge like that again. And this is the truth. This is the truth. This is how I choose to live my life. Do you know that show, What Would You Do? It's on TV. What Would You Do? They videotape people and they put them in awkward situations. You know what I'm talking about, circumstances. Then they videotape what your reaction would be. This is how I live my life. I walk down the street pretending that I am being videotaped, and how would I, if I was being videotaped, would I want to be represented? What is the truth of who I am, and how do I want others to see me? It was in that moment that I sincerely realized that I had to ask myself the question, Do I want to be part of the problem or part of the solution? Do I want to live in a world that walks away from somebody in need and just judge them? Do I want to be part of making a life where I can see a young lady crying all alone on the street, feeling alone, too frightened to even accept assistance or help from another? Or in my new version of my reality, not a dream, a reality of life, a reality of imagining her being surrounded by support. So I wiped it clean. I envisioned a flock of women walking over to her and encircling her in a womb of love. I imagined a young woman being witnessed by teenage women, and they were in awe and wonder with a deeper understanding of self, and maybe these younger women could have been singing to her the love song for them, a song of support. I picture people coming over on their honeymoon with sage advice, giving self-respect and self-love words of encouragement. And I believe that world is possible. First, I needed to change me. So I went home, and I do what I do, and I pray, because that works for me. When you use it, it works. I prayed over this beauty. I awoke with a new idea and a dream, and I imagined a world, not just a city, not just a country, not just our province, but the entire world, where if someone felt sad or was lonely or downtrodden, that we all came together, that there was love in the hearts of every person as they rallied together as a village, as a tribe, one heart beating together as one, like this spiritual family. I wear this shirt that says your vibe attracts your tribe. Who you are is what you're going to bring in, just like this amazing center where we get to share week after week. This young woman on Bernard may have felt that she had no voice. She didn't care if she was singing off key, and neither did I. I recognized her voice because to me, it was me, it was you, it was us, it was all of us, and all she needed was love. Love. I'm in love right now. That was love. Love is also forgiveness. Love overlooks the differences that we have, and it finds a point of reconciliation for others and even for ourselves. Love creates tolerance and human understanding, and that which we can become divided against ourselves, and without which we almost unconsciously become filled with criticism, condemnation, and false judgment. No one can be happy or enjoy the greatest fulfillment of life until they have come to see that most people try to do about the very best that we can. Don't we? When you know better, you what?
Do better.
You do better. When you know better, you do better. So when we're gentle with ourselves and gentle with the other person, that's when we're able to reach out beyond the coldness and the indifference of life, and reach through all of that, what I called earlier, intolerance or unkindness. And only then do we meet the divine center, which is forever established within each and every single one of us. So can't we please light the flame of love? Can't we? Human kindness, forgiveness, understanding in our own souls. It's what we had to do, and then let it shine so brightly, let that flame. And can't we decide to live each day from that light, from the flame of our spiritual knowledge and understanding and kindness and love, and that will ever and forever be understood and clear, not only with ourselves, but with each and every person that we come into contact with every single day in our lives. We have to make it time and time and time again. Ernest Holmes said, love and love again and love again. Some things that I do are so simple that help me find that place, that grounding, that help me stay centered in that kindness, in that love, that I would like to share with you guys. They're really easy, some of these practices. It's simple and it's easy. The first is, when I'm driving, which I don't do very often anymore, you know, I walk most places. When I'm driving, first I try not to be a backseat driver. Right, Mother? loving. I try to bless every other driver on the road. I do, especially those that I have challenges with, you know, that are driving. So I actually let everybody in front of me that wants to get in front of me. So watch what happens that over time within yourself and with others, how you start accommodating, you start just allowing that to come into your life. Another thing I do is I strive each and every day to find something that is beautiful to behold. Something, whether it's a point that is consciously, intentionally finding something to behold. It could be a flower, it could be a smile, it could be something. Walk out into your yard and see that dewdrop and really see the beauty in that leaf. Look at that great divine design and make it a practice. And then you're going to soon be looking for it and watching for it, and you're going to find it every single time. That divine design is everywhere. Look, it's in the eyes of everyone. It's in the hearts of everyone. The third thing I do, and I love this, is the random acts of kindness. You've heard it. Maybe you've been the receiver of it in front of a Starbucks line. I love when that happens and somebody gives you random acts of kindness. What if we were to choose again, consciously and intentionally, to initiate just one small random act of kindness each day as a spiritual practice? That's going to be your thing that you do. Not with any agenda, not with any expectation or notice or reciprocation, but as a practice of an altruistic giving, just because we can. It could even be something as small as smiling at the server at the grocery store or at the coffee shop. One small act each and every day, because that's what love is. That's what love is. That's what loving kindness is, and love is what you want it to be.
Or something like that. He used to hire us for $2.50 a day. I'll tell you how long ago that was. To set up cups, stock the chocolate bars, make sure all the pop was in the machine, just make sure everything was ready for the concert. So I was probably maybe 11 or 12 years old at the time. So this one particular concert was a guy by the name of, well, we thought it was a guy. His name, the band's name was Alice Cooper. Now, this is not a big arena. It's about 1,800 seats. So Alice Cooper was not famous at this time. He was infamous. He had not had any big hits, but our parents knew who he was. And there was no way in life my mother was ever going to let me see Alice Cooper. Not ever. But for $2.50, I got to be there at the arena, stocking the cigarettes, the chocolate bars and stuff, when they were doing their sound check. So there they were, this band, Alice Cooper. They all had long hair and freaky clothes. They were a little bit scary, because St. Catharines was a pretty conservative town at that time. We even thought, my friend and I speculated, that maybe they could smoke a marijuana. It was possible. So they do their sound check, and then afterwards, they come to the concession, and we're really frightened because these are big, old guys. They were probably at least 19 or 20 years old. And they come to the concession, and we see them, the band members, and then, you know, they say, Alice Cooper comes up to the counter, and he says to Mr. Batcher, he says, "What? How much food can we get for $5? And he looks at the band, and he says, "We've been on the road, man. We haven't eaten long time." So Mr. Batchelor looks at him and says, "You know what? Keep your money." He gave them each a hot dog, popcorn, chocolate bar, and a drink. And he said, "Pay me back when you're famous." And Alice Cooper was like, "Wow, man, this is great, man. Nobody's ever kind to us, man. You're the best, man. We will. We'll remember you, man. And when I'm famous, we'll pay you back, man. I will pay you back." And they never heard from him again. The point is, Mr. Batcher didn't give them the money or give them the food because he expected to get paid back. What he saw, beyond the hair and beyond the maybe the fact that he's moving and these sort of things, he saw four starving kids That's really all they were at this time. They weren't rich. They weren't famous. There were four starving kids, and he gave them food. So the science part of this story is, why does it feel so good to give and to be kind? What does it do? Well, obviously, it releases brain chemicals that make you feel good. They actually did a study in Santa Barbara with people who give gifts to their pets. Now, to non-pet people, it seems a little strange when people bestow gifts on little monkey or whatever. Well, we're laughing at it, but if you actually look, what they found is why people gift their pets is because there's no expectation of reciprocity. Your pet is not going to give you a gift back unless it's something you have to pick up in a bag. So people actually feel good about giving. You know, there is actually, in our society today, much of how we measure status is by what we have. But at one time, there were several indigenous tribes that used to hold potlatches. You've heard of potlatches, where a family would give everything they have. They would give it all away. And the status wasn't based on how much they had. It was based on how much they gave away. That's where they, and so acts of kindness actually make you feel good. Now, you're not just helping the person, but it actually makes you feel better. So, to sum up my talk, I'm going to go back to Alice Cooper, because everybody knows he's famous for his brilliant, insightful lyrics. And he said in one song, he said, you and me ain't no movie stars. What we are is what we are. We share some popcorn, some lovin', and TV. And that's enough for a working man. What I am is what I am. And baby, that's enough for me. What I am is what I am. And that's enough for me. Thank you. Now we'd like to sing School's Out.
That's the unprocessed, ladies and gentlemen. Friends, I have come to the frightening conclusion that I am the decisive element. I am the personal approach that creates my climate. It is my daily mood that makes my weather in my life. I possess tremendous power that makes life, my life, or somebody else's, miserable or joyous. I can be the tool or the torture technique or an instrument of inspiration. And I can humiliate, I can bring humor, I can hurt, or I can heal. It's all in me, it's all in you. In all situations, it is my response that decides whether a crisis gets escalated or de-escalated, and whether a person is humanized or dehumanized. If we treat people as they are, we may make them worse. I'm talking about when I was judging the woman on the street. If we treat people as they ought to be, then they and ourselves become capable of becoming who we're truly meant to be. In my opinion, kindness is even more potent. It's even a more potent agent than love, because you don't have to care about someone to be kind. It is, you nearly need to respect life. All life. All life. So today, I choose to be the place where the loving kindness can exist in the world. Are you with me in that? Do you choose to be the loving kindness where love exists everywhere in just your body temple and it exudes out to everything and everyone else? Will you repeat after me these words, if you are, these phrases, if you're willing? I am kind.
I am kind.
I forgive.
I forgive.
And I seek out.
I seek out.
And I find beauty.
And I find beauty.
Wherever I
Are
you with me?
Yep.
Are you coming?